Step lively. The sooner we get to the waterhole, the sooner we can leave.
So where are we really going?
An elephant graveyard.
Wow!
Shh! Zazu.
Right. So how are we gonna ditch the dodo?
Oh, just look at you two. Little seeds of romance blossoming in the savannah. Your parents will be thrilled. What with your being betrothed and all.
Be what?
Betrothed. Intended. Affianced.
Meaning?
One day you two are going to be married.
Yeah.
Ew. I can't marry her. She's my friend.
Yeah, it'd be too weird.
Oh, sorry to bust your bubble, but you two turtle doves have no choice. It's a tradition going back generations.
Well, when I'm king, that'll be the first thing to go.
Not so long as I'm around.
Well, in that case, you're fired.
Nice try, but only the king can do that.
Well, he's the future king.
Yeah, so you have to do what I tell you.
Not yet, I don't. And with an attitude like that, I'm afraid you're shaping up to be a pretty pathetic king indeed.
Not the way I see it.
Just can't wait to be king indeed. You know, Oscar Wilde once said, there are two tragedies in life. One is not getting what you want, and the other one is getting it. Welcome to the next lecture in the philosophical series of which we are deep diving into specific scenes in The Lion King. So this scene opens up pretty interesting, where Simba and Nala are trying to escape from Zazu. So you got to ask yourself, what then does Zazu represent, at least to these children? So, for Zazu, he's kind of an authority figure, but not an authority figure by himself, right? Because when he's there and he's talking to them, there's obviously a lot of dissent from Simba and Nala. They don't pay him attention at all. When he talks to them, they mock him even. But what he represents is something a little bit more powerful. He can go and tell the king. You know, so we talked before about Mufasa and why he chose Zazu as his right-hand man. And that's because a benevolent king has, or at least prioritizes, an eye that can see everything within the kingdom. They prioritize the eye. In fact, prioritizing Zazu is going to be something I use often throughout these lecture series. So, Zazu kind of represents the king's eye to Simba and Nala. They need to escape so that they can go do something that they're not allowed to do, which is go to the elephant graveyard. But symbolically, Zazu is the king's eye, you know? And it's the same reason why in Egyptian mythology, Horus is at the top of the pyramid. You know, Horus being the falcon. You know, the son of Osiris, the son of the great king, who has to fight Set, Osiris's brother. There's a reason why Horus is the hero in that story. Because a king becomes outdated. And we start to see that here. So this scene starts with a real problem. The idea of arranged marriages. Because while arranged marriages is still done in some places, we can at least understand the argument that a person should be able to choose who they spend the rest of their lives with, you know, who they choose to betroth, as Zazu put it. So we start with a good argument from Simba's side, where he's like, I don't want to marry her, you know. He says something odd and very childish after that, you know, she's my friend, I wouldn't want to marry my friend. Well, of course, you're going to want to marry a person who starts out as your friend, right? Anyway, the fact here is they start from a place that is considered archaic.
Listen, you little wiseacre. I'm smart, you're dumb. I'm big, you're little. I'm right, you're wrong. And there's nothing you can do about it.
You know, you see that clip right there and you know exactly what the individual is saying. He feels he's smarter just because he's an adult. And that's not the right way to go about things. So that's how the scene is kind of set up right there for you to empathize with Simba's case. He does have a good argument here. But what he does with that singular issue is when he goes too far in building his kingdom.
How many times do I have to tell you? I am not your buddy. I don't need your help. And I don't need you ever.
The next thing he does is he fires the advisor because of that tradition. And Zazu does say, this is a tradition that goes way back. This is above your personal ideology. This is greater than your personal ideology. And isn't that an interesting aspect, you know, where your personal ambitions are kind of close to you, but they are surrounded by cultural identity or cultural history and tradition. And that cultural tradition focuses on more people than just yourself. Now, that is a deep philosophical and psychological area that we're not really going to go over here because that is a little too advanced. But anyway, it's interesting to note how personal personal ambitions or personal traditions only affect really you and maybe a few others, but cultural and traditional ones affect many more people. So anyway, Simba fires the advisor because of this outdated and outmoded arranged marriage issue. And that is the beginning to jumping in that he's going to be a mighty king, the song that that transpires afterwards. So he feels like he doesn't want or need Zazu's help. You know, he is above Zazu as far as his knowledge, right? Which all of us know is absolutely ridiculous. There's a reason why Zazu is prioritized by Mufasa. There's a reason why Mufasa listens to Zazu as news from the kingdom, you know? But of course, I mean, Simba, he's young. So we give him that he's kind of ignorant in this aspect. But regardless, he fires the advisor and then he goes on to how he's going to be a great king. And more importantly, he points out what he's going to do, like his tenets and how he's going to build his kingdom. But the problem here is he's never ruled. Simba doesn't understand rule or being a king. And even if things arrived that would test his kingship, he's too ignorant at this point to even recognize them as kingly challenges, as we saw here where he fired the advisor immediately over a singular issue.
I know everything I need to know about you.
So what we have here is a person who thinks they know everything, now building his kingdom. You know, this is kind of the difference between like the French and American Revolution, you know? On one side, in the American Revolution, there were people who were separating from Great Britain that had led before. They were trained as leaders before, and they collaborated together, all the leaders, to create a constitution. And whether or not you believe in American Constitution or not is not the point here. The fact is that people who were in charge before created a constitution, and I'll just stick to the facts here. This constitution, this Declaration of Independence, in 244 years, created a system that has brought more people out of poverty than any other system in human history. And of course, the facts are, the cited sources are right there. So you have on one side people who had been in charge before, building their kingdom, building their government. But on the French Revolution, even though it started with the elite, as far as not the elite as in the monarch, it didn't start with the monarch, but it did start with the elite as in the rich and the wealthy class. But it was quickly taken over by the mob. People who had never been in charge, now suddenly having the power. And what happened? A funny little aspect of the Queen of Hearts to Alice in Wonderland, but there is some truth to this. The French Revolution started in 1789 and went well into the late 1790s. And during that time, King Louis XVI and Marie Antoinette were executed by guillotine. This would mark an era known as the Reign of Terror, where nearly 17,000 people were put to death. And arguably, almost 3,000 of them were to guillotine. So people who had never been in charge before were suddenly given the right to rule, and it quickly devolved into a mob mentality. We have a lot of examples of this going on right now, where mob rule is taking over. We'll go further into that, though, when we get to the hyenas. But for now, with Simba, we can understand that an individual who has never ruled and is very young is now trying to build his kingdom. And what happens in the song lets you know just how ignorant our little Simba is. So immediately, on his command, or really by his example, they all turn their back on Zazu, the king's eye, you know? And we slowly see the disrespect culminate on Zazu. And eventually, he's kind of banished to the most primitive parts of society, where two monkeys are picking fleas from his feathers. So now, with the bird out of the way, what kind of kingdom does Simba build?
Happy, happy, joy, joy, happy.
That's right. Everything is happy. Everybody's working together. It'll be a perfect utopia. But what happened to the perfect utopia that was built in Seattle? Their community garden was out of food within 24 hours. They were asking for provisions fairly early. They put up walls to barricade their division or barricade their place, and militia groups came in and took over. So what happened? Well, there was no rule of law. Being happy is a nice thing to tell certain people, but it's no way to rule many people. Because what makes one person happy may not make other people happy. In fact, it could be argued that one person's happiness could actually affect many others. Think about this. Anybody who's driving in Kau around 5 o'clock sees this happen. Where the traffic is flowing, everybody's going at a great pace. You have one person who greedily prioritizes their own happiness. They pull up in front of everybody else and stop. Everybody else becomes stopped. It's a traffic jam. One person's happiness ends up causing everybody else to be unhappy. All right? That's the problem of happiness. Isaiah Berlin talks about this if anybody's interested in political philosophy, but it's the two kinds of liberty. But the fact of the matter here is happiness works for singular people, but not for everyone. In fact, one person's happiness might actually get in the way of everybody else's. But Simba, he feels like he can build his kingdom on everybody being happy and disregarding the past, which is kind of what Zazu represents. And they build this nice little tower where for a split second, everybody is happy and the birds are circling around the top of the pyramid like it's a great ray of sunshine. But then one little thing happens, one person loses their balance, and the whole thing topples, and there's anarchy, and people, and the giraffes are breaking their necks, and the elephant falls on top of the horns and screams, and then everything comes crashing down, and Zazu tries to hold up as much as he can, but the problem is he's too weak, he's been banished, bam, flat. So there's a lot of symbolism in this song, you know, on how Simba builds his kingdom. So in conclusion, Simba has not played the fool yet. You know, he hasn't tried to be king yet. He hasn't tested himself in that kingly realm just yet. Therefore, he hasn't played the fool.
Oh!
But you need to learn how to follow before you can learn how to rule. And when you're learning something new, you're playing the fool's part. You don't know what you're doing. When you get a new job, for example, say you're a cashier at KTA or something like that, all right? You've never been a cashier before. Your first day, you had a little bit of training, but that training is only so you don't look absolutely stupid as you're doing things, you know? You need to play the fool in order to become a successful cashier. You know, you need to play the fool in order to be a successful pilot. You need to play the fool to be successful at anything. But playing the fool requires courage. Courage enough to know that for a little while, you are going to be a fool.
We should kind of like, you know, I don't know, maybe hang out this weekend or so. Oh, I'm sorry about that.
When you're stepping into a brand new position, you're going to get ridiculed. You know, you're gonna look like the fool, but the point is to keep trying. So where does this courage come from? Where does this courage come from to play the fool, to play the part in order to be successful?
What I'm trying to say is, we need your help!
That's right. It comes from using the knowledge of people around you, and that's what Simba lacked. He had the knowledge of the king right there in Zazu. And because he found one thing incorrect that we all might agree with, you know, when it comes to arranged marriage, because of that one thing, he felt like he could fire the king's advisor indefinitely. So the people around him that he could have used to gain knowledge, to gain a better understanding, and be prepared more to play the fool, he disregarded. And see, think about that. The people around you, the people you can learn from, the people who are wise, if you turn to them, you play the fool for a shorter amount of time. That's why when you're in training, if you really ask questions and you really try to figure out the ins and outs of the cashier work, you'll play the fool for a shorter amount of time. But if you aren't willing to play the fool at all, then you'll never be a master. See you next time.